It's the All Night Long Wrestling Podcast with the Enforcer.
I believe they're called Enforcers, Gordon.
I sell women's shoes.
And the Stallion.
Stallion, baby!
I am not what you would call a handsome man.
I'll kick you in the nuts and you'll smile at me and like it.
Oh, nice!
Welcome back to another edition of the All Night Long Wrestling Podcast, a holiday edition, if you will. Christmas joy is in the air. He is the Stallion. I am the Enforcer, and I'm coming to you live via satellite today. I was on that's what they say, right? When like somebody's gone, they say they're on assignment.
Yeah, that sounds right. Where are you on assignment this week?
I'm home. Yeah, I'm just I don't have my laptop, so we're using the iPhone 4. That's what I have. The iPhone 4.
Oh, nice. Is that like one of those flip phones?
Yeah, it's. I got it when I got my Motorola Razr, so it's right about the same time. Listen, it's my favorite show. Well, one of my favorite shows of the year, man. It's the All Night Awards show, hashtag All Night Awards, where you and I, the Stallion and the Enforcer, we're going to give you our picks for wrestler of the year, male and female, tag team of the year, promotion of the year, match of the year, breakout star of the year, disappointment of the year, and card of the year. We're going to ruffle some feathers today. All of my answers are going to be from wrestlers that have never once wrestled in America. I'm going on the Meltzer grading scale.
Oh, good. Okay. So this is being – you're live broadcasting from the Tokyo Dome is what you're saying.
Absolutely. Yeah. 7 stars in the Tokyo Dome. Seven – count them, 7 stars. But listen, before we get to the show, the All Night Awards show, if you will, we got to thank a couple people. We got to thank our Wrestling Perspective podcast friends over there. We want to thank Damage 365 Radio Network. Also, our friends at Blue Chew. Because if you got your stocking stuff this year, it's probably because you went to Blue Chew, you typed in the promo code WPP, and you paid $5 for shipping and handling, and you got your free order of Blue Chew. Joe, was that in your stocking this year?
No. No, it was not, but I wish that it was. I mean, it would certainly...
improve the holidays. You want to get some circulations and blood flow. You want to get a better pump in the gym or anywhere else for that matter. Better pump in the bedroom. Better pump, you know, pump in gas. Who knows? You want to get a better pump. You go to Blue Chew, WPP, pay $5 shipping and handling. And your first order is on us too. Because you want everybody to be walking around like Santa Claus. That's what I'm telling you. And if you don't know where to find us, I mean, you probably do by now. You're watching us right now. Twitter, Instagram, at All Night Long WP, YouTube, All Night Long Wrestling Podcast. Subscribe, like, rate, review, iTunes, Wrestling Perspective Podcast on iTunes. Joe, what am I forgetting? I got 15 drops here. Anything else?
I think you got it all, buddy. It's a great job by you, as usual.
It's a lot to remember. Sometimes I kind of just word vomit. And if you followed us on Instagram during Christmas, there were a lot of good Christmas pictures I got out there, man. The Christmas Creature. Got some Chance, got some Hunter on there. And my gift last night, which you actually know sold tight, is the WWF Steel Cage Challenge plug and play. I haven't played it yet, dude, but it's a Steel Cage Challenge plug and play that goes in any TV. I mean, it's a gift that keeps on giving.
Oh, it's a great job. Was it your sister that picked that up for you?
It was my sister. She knows me all too well. I was hoping for NES as King of the Ring, but, you know, I'll settle for the Steel Cage Challenge. True story about the NES version of King of the Ring. I believe it had Quang, and the Game Boy version didn't. I always wanted to play as Quang. Never did.
Hey, man, sometimes you got to hold on to those dreams.
And that's why we have New Year's resolutions. I'm resolving to get my Nintendo. I mean, speaking of Nintendo, you got an SNES Classic, bro. What are you doing, right? You shouldn't be on this podcast. You should be out there playing Biker Mice from Mars, baby. Huh? Yoshi's Island. All kinds of fun stuff on there.
Well, Mike, my life is meaningless, so I'm here doing this podcast because I want to get our 2018 year-end awards out there for everybody to listen to, so that's why I'm here.
If your life is meaningless and you're doing this podcast, does that mean this podcast is meaningless?
And it's like one of them one of them brain teasers maybe people can think about as we go through the awards here and come up with an answer at the end of the show.
Speaking of going through these awards, I'm going to let – do you have the categories in front of you?
We're going to go with yes.
Okay. Where do you want to start?
Let's start with let's bookend it maybe with the wrestlers of the year. So do you want to start with female wrestler of the year to kind of kick it off on a high note?
Sure. I will start with female wrestler of the year, and I went back and forth in this one. I got a 1A and a 1B. For me, the female wrestler of the year is clearly Megumi Sakura. No, I'm just kidding. I just pulled the Dave Meltzer on you. Female wrestler of the year is Becky Lynch. She has commanded the professional wrestling world since SummerSlam and her turn on Charlotte Flair, and she's the hottest thing going. The new Stone Cold Steve Austin, whatever you want to call her, but she is making the most money. She draws the most houses. People tune into SmackDown for her. So for me, it's going to be Becky Lynch, but Charlotte is a close number two. She got the big win over Asuka at WrestleMania, but she's had great matches. But as far as kind of changing the business right now, I'm going with Becky Lynch.
Yeah, I went with Becky Lynch as well, and it was an interesting one to think about because I feel like when I looked back at the year, I couldn't remember a whole lot of what Becky Lynch did prior to maybe the summer this year. So, but I think that her impact has been significant enough to warrant the fact that she deserves the, you know, to be the female wrestler of the year for this year. Charlotte also had a good year, but I think that, you know, the SmackDown women's title was kind of mired in Carmella for a while. And, I can't really say that nobody really stood out on Raw to me. Rousey's still a rookie, so I feel like you can't really give it to her. And from other promotions, I mean, there are other good female wrestlers out there, but I think Becky stands out. So I think it's she's deserving of that honor for 2018.
That's fair. From female, you know, wrestler of the year, let's go with breakout star of the year. Who do you have the breakout star of the year, Joe?
This was an interesting one too because there was a few guys I was considering for this just for various different reasons. But I ended up going with Hangman Adam Page for this year because I feel like as he's been on the rise as a wrestler for a few years now, but I feel like this was the year where he really kind of came into his own as a singles competitor, whereas maybe in years past he was, you know, he was, as far as since he's been in the Bullet Club, he's been tied to the Young Bucks. They had the six-man tag titles for a little while, and you know, before that he was in the Decade. But I think he really came into his own as a singles competitor this year and wrestled some matches in New Japan, and he was able to have singles feuds on Ring of Honor pay-per-view. So I went with him. It was a toss up between him and Flip Gordon for me. So I ended up going with Hangman Adam Page.
I like both those answers. I went a little bit differently, a little off the beaten path, and I went with Pentagon. To me, Pentagon is a guy that, you know, you saw in Lucha for a long time, but when he this year he commanded Impact and MLW and All In. And I feel like Pentagon is, and of course, PWG. And to me, when you talk about, you know, desired talents and people like you see them on a card, you're like, man, I really want to watch that guy's match. To me, Pentagon is one of the biggest names out there. And he's a little bit off the beaten path. But to me, he's a guy that really stood out in 2018.
Yep, that's definitely a good choice. And yeah, and he's been in a few different places. So,
and he's been the other guy, and I don't want to go into all the honorable mentions, but the other guy I was thinking of was Sami Callihan. And Sami Callihan, actually, for the same reason, he main evented in Impact, he main evented in MLW, very similar career path to Pentagon. And he's done a lot of good stuff since he left WWE as Solomon Crowe. So good for Sami Callihan, too.
All right. Where do you want to go next?
Let's go with tag team of the year.
Yeah, this is an interesting one too. I was torn between two teams on this one, but I'm gonna end up going with the Young Bucks, and I went with them just because I think of their impact on the wrestling business overall. They, of course, put on consistent quality matches no matter where they are, whether it's in Ring of Honor or New Japan.
And a different style, not to interrupt you, but they, ever since Matt Hart is back, they've been telling different stories, and their matches have definitely morphed from what they were. So I think that's a really good pick by you.
Yeah, I just think that they continue to grow and do different things and invent new moves. And I think they themselves had said this was their favorite year as far as in the business was concerned. which is cool to hear from them. So I went with the Young Bucks this year. I was considering Undisputed Era as the other option, but I went with the Young Bucks. So.
It's a good pick. I went with the Young Bucks the last 27 years. So just for that, I want it to be a little bit different. They did have a great year, but another team to me that really stood out this year is LAX, a.k.a. EYFBO, Ortiz and Santana. These guys, they've had unbelievable matches throughout the year in Impact, but they've also done really good stuff in Progress as of late. You and I saw them versus CCK in Progress in New York City, and then they came back and they wrestled in Progress the last couple of shows, and those are two guys that do different stuff, man. They do really good stuff. They do each match is different. It's not the same formulaic, you know, kind of moves over and over and over. And I think they're poised for a huge run in 2019. I don't know if it's going to end up with them going NXT or something like that, but those are two guys, man, I love watching right now. So I'm a big fan of LAX, and my runner-up is actually Undisputed Era too.
Nice. Good call. How about, I believe we have biggest disappointment of the year in 2018.
I put a picture of myself on it. So
I just put up a mirror. That's what I usually do.
I feel bad for my wife. I'm just a walking disappointment. Who do you got first, buddy? Can you go ahead?
This was probably the, I don't want to say it was the toughest one, but it was the one I had to think about the most as far as what the biggest disappointment was for me, whether it was, you know, it could be anything, right? It could be a pay-per-view. It could be a company. It could be an angle. It could be a promotion. Some of the stuff is easy pickings. You know, I could just say like Raw, and I think everybody would understand.
I have my answer, and then I have / WWE.
Right. But I went with the Authors of Pain as my biggest disappointment, because I was pretty excited for when they came up to the main roster. I thought that they had a good run at NXT, and they made some strides as a team. Like, I don't really know who they were, you know, before they were in NXT, so it wasn't like they were a bunch of name guys coming off the indies or anything like that. And they had a good, you know, they developed a good gimmick with Paul Ellering as their manager. They didn't lose very much in NXT. They came up to the main roster. I thought they would kind of solidify the Raw tag team division, which is where they show that they wound up on. And instead, they were kind of on TV, off TV, on TV, off TV. And then they were given Drake Maverick as a manager, which I still don't know that makes a whole lot of sense. And
a lot of things were peed on around them too.
Yeah, there's been a lot of urination angles with them. And then they did win the tag titles finally, and subsequently lost them after like 6 weeks. So from being a dominant team that was pretty over in NXT to being, you know, a middle of the road team that hasn't even really been on Raw the last couple of weeks after losing the tag titles and has a manager that likes to urinate on stuff. That was probably the biggest disappointment for me as far as this year was concerned. I was looking forward to them getting a main roster run, and it just hasn't really worked out.
I was afraid you and I were going to have the same pick on this one. They were right up there for me, but for me, number one's got to be Andrade Almas. The dude was drafted to SmackDown, and then you didn't even see him for six, seven months. I think it was like 2 months he wasn't on the show, and then he was doing some like enhanced matches, and this week he just got pinned by Mustafa Ali. To me, Andrade Almas was NXT for a long time. He was their champion. Zelina Vega, he's got a great valet in her, and they can be doing so much more. He's finally like a little bit higher on the card, but I mean, losing claim to Mustafa Ali, no disrespect to Mustafa Ali whatsoever. I love the cruiserweight guys are getting a push, but I mean, it's got to be Almas out of everybody, Joe. It's got to be Almas.
Yeah, that's a good choice. I mean, I've been very frustrated with how he's been used on SmackDown.
Yeah. And what were your runners up? You have anything honorable mention here?
Oh gosh, there's a lot of things that were disappointing. A lot of it, I think, is NXT call-ups. I think a lot of folks that have come up from NXT that had a good run down there have not done very much on the main roster, and it may not be any fault of their own. I think it's just that's how it's gone. I think those are some of the things, I guess, that really kind of stuck out to me.